Hello, everybody, and welcome to a very special podcast that I'm going to be doing talking about anime studios with my special guest, Canepa of The Canepa Effect.
Hello. A very special podcast, I'm honored.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like every podcast is always a very special podcast, and every guest is a special guest.
You don't have to
guest.
Downplay it now. Could have just left that at a very special podcast, I'm honored to have you.
Yeah, well, I am honored to have you finally on this show, because I've been wanting to talk to you for a while about this sort of, I guess I'd put it that both of us have an issue with the way that people talk about anime studios in the anime community, that there's a lot of misunderstandings, misinformation, and just general confusion about studios, and it comes up in a lot of just small aggravating ways in the ways that people talk about stuff.
Yeah.
And I know you've got a video, you've got a bunch of videos, rather, about studios in general, and your channel is sort of dedicated to individual creators, like taking someone and exploring their career, or even if you look at a studio, you focus mostly on the people who work for that studio, as opposed to like the greater idea of the studio as a whole. You want to talk about sort of your approach and why you do things this way?
Yeah, the whole idea is that so many people, I think a lot of anime critique has come from video game critique, and talking about video game developers in when talking about games just kind of makes sense, because you have these very structured studios, they do most things in-house, and you kind of can get an idea of the sort of products, and they're probably a bit more open about things, whilst so many anime studios are a lot smaller than people think, and there's a lot of freelance creators, and the anime industry is very much run by human connections. This person's friends with this person, this person went to a party with this person.
So I want to say the anime industry as a whole is way smaller than people seem to realize. Like,
absolutely.
You see the same names popping up everywhere constantly, and like you said, people can meet at a party and that's how a show gets made. And
One of the big problems right now is in regards to writers. There's not enough anime writers, and so you've got these people who are like labeled under series composition, and you see that there's just like probably about 100 of them just doing everything, and it's ridiculous.
It's sad. It's why anime writers, I think, are one of the hardest staff to talk about, because when you see an animator, it's a lot easier to point at all their work and say, well, look, it all looks kind of similar. And then you get a writer like, let's say, Yoshida Reiko, who, you know, wrote K-On! And Tamako Market, and like, between those two shows, you see this obvious connection. But then you look at the, like, 150 other shows she wrote, and some of them you're like, well, this is nothing like K-On!, so how do I reconcile this, you know?
Yeah, and then you kind of have to reinterpret the role of what a writer actually does, because often, even on original series, it'll be the director and a producer who come up with the story, and then the writer comes along later and just kind of fleshes things out a bit.
I mean, we see it in that scene in Shirobako where they're changing the last episode of Exodus, and it's like, you know, it's the director's idea. He just kind of calls the writer in and tells him, like, here's what we're going to do instead, and the writer just pens that out, you know? And you get the sense in that case that the writer is not there to be a creator. They're there to be a cog in the machine, sort of. Like, they're just the person who can put the pen to paper. You know, the director doesn't know how to write dialogue, but this writer can bring his vision to life. I guess sort of like how in comics, there's always like four credits. You've got the writer, illustrator, colorist, and, you know, sometimes you can read two comics that were drawn by the same guy, and the colors can be completely different because he didn't do that job, you know. And I think that there's a lot of this in anime that's perhaps underexplored. I want to ask, what do you think is? Do you think there's like one big misconception that maybe is the biggest one that's a problem?
Well, the biggest misconception in general is talking about budget in anime, and I know you've talked about that as well. I just think the idea, one of the big things that I hate so much is, do you know Malgraph?
Do you say Malgraph?
Yeah.
I think so. You'll have to help me.
I've never actually used it, so this probably is an awful explanation, but it's the idea that you put your scores into My Anime List, and then you put it through this program, and then that program tells you like what your favorite studio is, genre, and all that.
Yeah, I've seen that. So, it was really funny because I put it through, and of course, A1 Pictures was my least favorite by like a long shot, and I was like, "Well, this surprises nobody," you know.
But that idea of equating a show directly with a single studio, and then kind of judging a studio based only on the stuff they've created, because there's a lot more nuances to it. There's some shows, I think it was Digimon Try, that's it. It's labeled under Toei Animation, but I think most of it is outsourced, and so animation production is just that. It's animation production, not necessarily animation creation, if that makes any sense.
Right. I mean, you can see, definitely if you look at a show that suddenly seems like it is totally different from what you're used to from this studio, I wonder why, and then it's always like, maybe because the people who worked on it aren't those people, you know?
Exactly, and that's why I've constantly advocated for looking at not just animators, directors, character designers, art directors, but also looking into producers as well, because there's a lot of really, really influential producers that kind of get overlooked. And I think Sunrise in particular, that studio's got 13 different sub-studios, and there's always like this core producer, and he's always got his own ideas about kind of where the studio is going, what he appreciates.
Is it that guy's name who's listed as the creator on Hajime Yatate, I think, who's listed as like a creator on every original Sunrise show? There's a credit like that. There's one credit that appears on almost every Sunrise show, and I think it's just like, I've never been sure if it's an actual person or if it's just like the entity of Sunrise as encapsulated in this one name, you know. It's strange, but he's on everything.
I just looked it up, and it is just, that's just what they call Sunrise. That's ridiculous.
It's funny because I've seen people talk, very rarely, but I have seen at least once where someone was like, "Man, my favorite anime director is Hajime Yatate. He's done so much incredible work. Can you believe the same guy who created Cowboy Bebop created Gundam?" And I'm like, "Well, hold on."
Oh god. Actually, Ufotable had the same thing. They had a mangaka which was just called Tartan Check. And it was just, instead of one person, it was this small group of Ufotable staff that made Ufotable manga, which got adapted.
Yeah, I know that a lot of like manga that are based off of shows will just credit the studio. You see this with Bones. Any manga based on a Bones show will just be credited as like story by Bones, which doesn't make any sense. But you know,
it's more sensible than coming up with a random name to represent your studio, though. Like Hajime Yatate, like they even do have like a kanji for it as well. Like it's a proper name.
It's funny because now I think about it, I did the same thing. I used to have I wanted to make a production studio called Modal Soul Productions, where the idea was that everyone could just be credited as Modal Soul, and it's just like an anonymous collective of one guy.
Have fun getting people to agree to that.
Yeah. Well, I thought I did it more as a way for people to hide themselves if they wanted to. You know, everybody could just use this pseudonym and nobody had to out themselves. This is earlier into the internet, before, you know, Google made you put your name on your profiles.
That's actually interesting. I've never actually met anyone. Okay, no, I've met a few people that specifically don't want to put themselves out there, but I've never heard of someone who wants to go under a group pseudonym and not want their work credited back to them.
I've seen some stuff like that before, and it's interesting. I mean, I would never be that guy, you know, like I would want everyone to know exactly what I did.
But, we're all massive egomaniacs, it's YouTube.
Yeah. that's what the website should have been called. Massive Egomaniacs, the website. But so in general, there's definitely this big misunderstanding about studios, but I'm also concerned about the pendulum swinging too far in the other direction. And this is where I think you and I have sort of butted heads online a bit, is that I'm concerned that if we only focus on individuals and their effects, then we can ignore the fact that the studio does have some influence. And I think that studios kind of have like a culture or a personality that comes through regardless of who's working on the show. And there's just moments where I observe like a trend going on where even though none of the staff are the same, the show feels alike, you know? And it kind of.
There's specific examples, and I made a video in 2015, which was badly titled and probably badly written, because the examples that I put into it were just awful, which was called Why the Anime Studio Doesn't Really Matter. And right. I thought, everyone's going to read that title exactly how I read it, which is Why the Anime Studio Doesn't Really Matter. But... yeah, my kind of stance on it now is anime studios matter, but in different ways and in different situations, depending on the size and the priorities of producers. But that's not exactly trendy title.
I think we can make a pretty clear distinction between like Kyoto Animation, which I think everyone understands to be like this tight-knit studio that does... They they do everything in-house. They even do their own backgrounds, right? I mean,
They do their own digital compositing work. Everything is encapsulated in that kind of massive studio that's constantly growing, and it's got its own school where they train animators to, like, with their own animators. So everything's kind of this group psychology.
And then on the far opposite end of the spectrum, we've got A1 Pictures, which is not... even a studio, I guess. According to your video, they're sort of just a bunch of producers.
Producers, production assistants. There's some in between checkers there. They actually have a CG department. I don't know if that's a recent development or not, but they do have their own CG team, which is kind of unique. But A1 Pictures is pulled together by A1 Pictures producers contacts and Aniplex contacts. So one of the examples I've used before is Megumi Kono, who is animated all of Shelter, did a load of work on The Idolmaster. And with her, you can kind of start to draw connections between a producer called Yosuke Toba, who is this... I consider him one of the most important Aniplex producers, because he was the guy who walked up to Jun Maeda and walked up to Kenji Horikawa of PA Works' producer and basically just set up Angel Beats just because he wanted to see it.
I know that that's sort of... I don't remember which producer it was, and I know it's an anime... Aniplex producer could even be the same guy that did the same thing with Madoka. Like, that show came into existence because the producer sort of put Urobuchi Gen and Shinbo together. I remember reading about this on Animapple Torre, a site that I don't think is alive anymore, but it was like a younger, I think, Korean guy who would, like, translate Japanese interviews and stuff into English, and he was very big into Shaft and was, like, always talking about... Incidentally, he had written a bunch about Angel Beats as well as a huge failure that he deeply resented, but... Yes, go on.
Oh, the producer you're talking about is Atsuhiro Iwakami.
Yeah, from what I understand, he sort of... And I remember when I heard that, it was kind of a shocking realization to think, like, yeah, the producer probably, you know, has a lot more to do with this stuff than people realize. Like,
yeah, absolutely.
But also, it's... Oh, man... Have you been to a lot of, you've been to a lot of anime conventions, right? I know you went to Anime Expo last year.
I went to Anime Expo. That's my only American one, but I've done a couple here in Australia.
Have you sat in on a lot of industry panels?
I went to two in Melbourne.
So I'll tell nothing is more deeply frustrating than the Q&A at any industry panel.
Yeah.
Because you'll get something like for instance, in the Madoka case, that producer was at Otakon a couple years back when that show was coming out in the U.S., and they ran the first three episodes, and people are asking him things like, what does the witch language mean? Like, how'd you come up with that? And I'm like, that guy doesn't know that. Why would he know that?
Like, he probably watched the guy that know that, that knew yeah. that, but, like, he'd have to make a phone call to find it out.
Yeah, exactly. And there's just so little understanding of what these... Because the way they kind of present these guests at conventions, because it's difficult to explain what a producer does, they just kind of put a guy's name next to a show, and then everyone just wants to ask about the shows. You know, like, they just want to ask whatever question they happen to have about Madoka, not so much what this particular guy could answer.
Yeah.
It's like, I think there's sort of an idea that anybody who touched the show knows everything about it. I mean, we see the same thing even with voice actors who will get asked, like, writing questions, you know?
And they're just having to, like, make up answers on the spot based on descriptions they've been given. Yeah, I think that producers at anime conventions are wholly underutilized. Like, I feel like there should be, like... kind of a preview, a precursor, just where someone comes up and explains exactly who this person is and exactly what sorts of questions would be great. Because I sat in on some interviews for Sword Art Online Ordinal Scale. Tomohiko Ito was there, Shingo Adachi, and one of the producers. And consistently what would happen is like... there'd be an outlet that would come up, they'd ask some questions, and the person who was asked the least amount of questions was that producer, and that's someone who's been around the whole production, he's seen everything, seen how it's organized, and because I'm really, really interested in the business side of anime, and I know Miles from Crunchyroll shares that kind of enthusiasm, and it's just kind of annoying to see that people... don't really do the research to be able to take advantage of their presence, because producers are amazing.
Yeah, I mean, Kenji Horikawa, that's the PA Works producer, right?
Yeah, I interviewed him at Anime Expo.
President as well, right?
Yeah.
Of PA Works. And he was at Otakon. I imagine, a similar presentation of what they did at Anime Expo. They had their whole PA Works museum thing and everything, and I got the sign.
But you guys got the art director. You got Kazuki Yoshiji there.
Which was great. He's hilarious and awesome. And he did a live demonstration of how he does his art, which was another... That's, oh man, there's just so many layers on, like, when you understand how stuff in anime is made, it kind of changes the whole perspective on everything.
Yeah.
Where that guy is an entirely digital artist, and so much of how he, like, most of what he does to make his backgrounds is templates. Like, not templates as in... like a pre-drawn thing or something, but he has like all these certain brushes that will just be, let's say, a random splotch of green, and then he'll just like clone stamp that 100 times and then do that with 3 different colors, and then it starts to look like a tree eventually. And it's like, you look at a PA Works show, and I think a lot of people would imagine this guy slaving over hand drawing every single detail in this scene, and it's like, no, that's not even close to what he's doing, you know? He just happens to really understand how to do digital work. I mean, he put together he didn't do a full one, but he put together like the majority of what would be a Nagino Asakura background in a 1-hour panel while doing Q&A, you know? So... yeah, there's a lot that once you know it, it's like, oh, this changes the game a little bit.
Yeah. Also, interesting to note that Kazuki Yoshiji is kind of like a marvel when it comes to background directors, especially when in that he's freelance. Like, he's not hired by PA Works, but he works entirely with them, because his right. philosophy on being a background director is that he wants to be involved in the animation production progress rather than working for a background studio, which is how it's usually done. Like, usually a producer at an anime studio or director will get Studio Pablo or Studio Easter, and then they'll go and do their entire thing, like, separate from the production. So that's why I kind of love PA Works.
Can be unhealthy, because I don't know about you, but Studio Pablo backgrounds look great and all, but Owari no Serif, it was pretty jarring that the backgrounds and characters looked like they were from different shows to me.
Oh, yeah. But Studio Pablo does all of their stuff hand-drawn as well, so you've got these amazingly detailed backgrounds that I don't want the front of the show, I just want those backgrounds on big posters.
So does anybody know who Studio Pablo is? Like, I mean, there's such a consistent style. Is it like, how big is this background studio? Is it like five guys? Or
who, it's more than five, but it's not many. It's 10, 20. I've been trying to make a video on them for a while, but I just need to sift through staff blogs, because the best sorts of studio websites are ones that have blogs. There's one guy on that studio who doesn't talk about his work at all. He just talks about how much he loves fish and all of his fishing trips that he takes.
Oh, that's great.
It's amazing. I'll be going through one and it's like someone going, oh, flip flappers, here's the design, like here's how we painted this part. And then I just flip over to the next one and it's just a guy fishing.
Well, you know, it's a social media account. Doesn't have to be about his job.
Yep, exactly.
maybe he's got a business Twitter somewhere that you could that's
hidden. there's got to be somewhere to find what he actually does all day apart from his days off going fishing.
So I feel like we're in this state of kind of constantly going deeper, and there's a lot of difficulty here because I'm going to kind of address this at you, because you were very hesitant to do this podcast with me because you wanted to do more research. And I think if we worry too much about that, we're just going to stop ourselves from saying anything.
Yeah.
Because I just said about Studio Pablo, like, and I feel somewhat similar because, like, I've never addressed background studios in my videos because I don't know anything about them. So I just, like, I'm afraid to even say anything. Like, I feel confident talking about K-On's backgrounds or something because I know exactly how they were made. Like, I've seen the original reference footage. I know Kyoto Animation does location shoots. I've seen videos of them walking around taking photos for disappearance and stuff. Like, I know what they do. But then when it comes to like Wit Studio or something, where they're new and there's not a ton of information and everything they do is really different and strange, and I'm like, I don't want to even touch this, you know. But then on some level, if I don't, who will? And how long are we going to wait before we have all the info? And I don't know, how long have you been, like, online talking about anime? I'm curious.
Anime in general, since 2014. But I talked about industry since 2015.
Because I got into anime blogging in 2007, and what I observed was it really was like 2009 when even studios were really being addressed. Like, there were definitely people who knew studios and they'd come up in advertising. Like, everybody in the early 2000s, every magazine would talk about Gonzo. Like, Gonzo, they were sort of pushing the envelope with CG and everything, which I guess because it looked fancy and new, it was kind of celebrated by a lot of the Western anime magazines. It's like, oh, this is the cutting edge. This is the best-looking anime on TV right now, which was not always true. But they would advertise a lot of stuff as, like, from the creators of Hellsing, from the people who brought you this. But in anime discourse online, no one talked about, like, creators at all, unless it was Satoshi Kon or Hayao Miyazaki or, like, you know, some director who we all knew who had a very distinct style, Mamoru Oshii. And then it was, I could be wrong about this, and it might be oversimplifying it and just saying what was going on in my side of the community, but to me it was, like, Shaft that opened the door for it. For, like, talking about studios, because they had such a distinct style that looked like no other shows, and so Shaft had its, like, very dedicated cult following, and Akiyuki Shinbo did, And that's where, that's like what inspired like me and a lot of other people to start talking about studios. And it's just really funny to me to think that back in 2009, I was writing a series called Studio, Yours is Studio Spotlight.
Yes.
As Nino's. Mine was Studio Studies. I had a series called Studio Studies, which would basically be like, I had one, for instance, on UFO Table, before or right after Kata no Kyokai. And you know, and for me, Studio Studies at the time meant, here's all the shows they made. Isn't that interesting? You know, these shows were all made by the same guy. They all have kind of similar elements. That's cool. I didn't know the first thing about people who actually worked for UFO Table. I could not name a director. I still can't, you know. Which even then, it'd be difficult to do that because a lot of the early shows would have multiple directors and you can't even tell what episodes they worked on because it's like unmarked.
In kanji at the end, and
right.
Japanese hadn't been invented then.
Yeah, exactly.
Nobody could speak moments, it.
I've had these moments now where, like, when I was doing my Akiyuki Shinbo in the 90s videos, I don't know if you've seen those at all, but
yeah.
That's where I went really in depth, like looking at everybody who worked on all these shows. And like, I'm watching the show Galaxy Fraulein Yuna Returns, which was one of Shinbo's shows with JC Staff in the late 90s. And I'm watching the credits, and up comes the name of, what the hell is his name? The guy who directed Naruto.
Naruto.
He did Bleach, he did most of Noriyuki Abe. Noriyuki Abe shows up as a storyboarder on this episode, and I'm like, wait a minute, I just saw it in the credits. It hadn't been listed on any, it wasn't on Anime News Network, it wasn't on AnyDB, nowhere online do they mention that he did this episode. I think it was him. I believe it was Noriyuki Abe I'm talking about. It could be another guy, but I think it was him. And I just remember I was watching this ending theme, and I'm like, oh my god, I'm that guy now.
Yeah.
I'm the guy who just found the credit in the ending theme of this 20-year-old anime. But the thing is, 10 years ago, nobody would have cared who Noriyuki Abe was. Or a big one that Josh from Wave Motion Cannon keeps trying to like bring up, Atsushi Wakabayashi, whom, like, I found out about from doing the Shinbo in the 90s video, and I found out about him as an animator and a animation director, and I was like, well, this guy's pretty cool, so I mentioned him a bunch in that video series, and even then, I didn't realize that he's also done, like, all this other shit, and he's, like, actually important. Like, I just thought he was a key animator. I didn't know he was, like, a major animation director. He's actually directed shows. I think it was Gwyn Saga that because Josh just translated an interview with him talking about Gwyn Saga. So, yeah, I was like, whoa. So it's like we're constantly going down this rabbit hole with this information. And, you know, I'm always worried that if we stop ourselves from talking about stuff, then, like, because we haven't done enough research, then it's like, even the stuff we have researched, we might find out we were wrong about all of it 5 years from now when we have more information.
I have nightmares about that. Please don't say it.
I can't embrace the idea of trying to always be right, because even my own opinions, I don't trust 6 months after I've had them. You know,
I do think there's something to always striving for as accurate as possible, and based on any evidence that you have, I do get nervous every time, because I do have animators who want to be in the industry and animators that are in the industry following me. So the idea of waking up one morning and getting a big long post from some professional about all of the things I got wrong is just terrifying to me. So
I mean, my advice would be, here's your response. Thanks, I'll fix it and put it up again. Like,
you can't do that. You can't take down a video. And now they're taking away annotations, so I can't even do what I used to do, which is just put a box in the top left corner saying everything about this sentence is wrong.
Yeah. Well, people on mobile never saw that sentence in the first place, which is why they're getting rid of annotations. It's unfortunate. Yeah, YouTube needs to introduce some way to fucking fix that, to make it so you can fix it. I mean, you can actually delete segments from video. I don't know if you're aware of that.
Yeah, but it kind of screws things up, and it's never clean.
Well, yeah, that's the difficulty of it, is you're always afraid that once it's in print, it's going to be there forever. But at the same time, the people spreading the misinformation, they are hitting print. So it's like, yeah, we gotta hit them back, because otherwise we're going to be the losing tide here, you know? Like, if everyone like who has information is too afraid to... It can be a war, like this whole budget myth thing. Like,
okay, that does feel like a battle at times. Yeah,
because it's so proliferates the culture. Like, as long as I've been into anime, I've heard the word budget. You know, and I'm sure I used it a lot back in the day, because
I did as well.
And no reason to question it. And then one day you just find out. You find out that One Punch Man had a normal budget, and you go, well, hold on, everything I've been told is a lie, clearly.
Oh, I wrote interview questions for him when he went to Texas, so I addressed that specifically. I was like, mentioned this, does it annoy you that people keep on thinking that? Just hoping that he would expand on his answer. And then he said, pretty much all anime has the same budget. And I kind of just had this moment where I was like, oh God, what do I do with this information now? I've got this million, like, I've got all of these quotes about budget, about how 3D is more expensive than 2D, which is, people often say, oh, it's 3D animation, oh, it's just cheap. And just so many things about how animation quality does not equate with budget, and I try to put it together, try to form arguments with it, and it goes nowhere, because people say, oh,
well, that's
mistranslation or something.
This is what I think everyone is failing to understand, is that the budget is by and large given to them at the start of the production.
Oh, yeah.
And then they have to figure out what to do with it. And I think that's what everyone's misunderstanding, is that, like, they're imagining this idea where, like, they every week get a paycheck of budget, and then they have to spend that on each episode. And it's like, no, at the start of the production, they have to make a decision, like, what is important to us? If you make a show where, like for instance... I wouldn't be surprised. This is just going to be pure conjecture. I'm about to spitball some shit that could all be wrong. But this is just a random example of... Here's a random example of a possibility for consideration. Let's just... a thought experiment, if you will. None of what I'm about to say is factual. But, Do-Da-Da-Da is a show that was originally by Brainspace. One of the producers, the producer of the show, she went and formed a new studio to produce more Do-Da-Da-Da, and eventually 91 Days, and I think they did the new Natsume Yujin show as well.
Yep.
So they, what's it, Shuka, I think? They
yes,
go off
Studio
and
Shuka.
Make this new studio to make Do-Da-Da-Da. They're going to make 3 fucking seasons of it, and everyone watches it, and the animation is kind of dog shit in a lot of the episodes. There's one episode that is, like, not animated at all. It's like a hideous slideshow. And I have to think, well, what costs a lot of money in Do-Da-Da-Da? You've got a gigantic cast of, like, 40 characters, and all of them have really big name seiyuu. Everyone in the show is, like, a famous celebrity voice actor. So how much of the budget goes to just hiring all those fucking voice actors onto this show, you know?
I'm not sure that's the thing where I have to, like, step in and say, that's not factually accurate. There is no evidence to support the idea that, that's what happens, but...
No, there's not, but it's an interesting thought, right? Like, what if there's something that costs more, that they spent their money on instead of animation, you know? What if it's not that every dollar had to go... Like, it's not like a dollar equivalent of your budget goes into a dollar of animation. If you've got a show where, you know, maybe you're going cheap on the backgrounds, and therefore you can afford more character animation or something.
That's,
you know?
Yeah, that's not how it works.
Well, explain yourself.
Okay, the issue with Durarara specifically was it was, a new studio starting to establish itself, and they were given 3 cores. They got split cores so that they could catch up on things. But the show in general had production issues all the way through, and so they didn't have the time. And a lot of the time, My favorite example that I always bring up is Girls and Panzer. Am I thinking of Girls and Panzer? Yes, Studio Actus. It was an amazing, like, hugely selling show, like, sold loads for its year, except the studio itself lost money on it. And wow. that was because they got behind schedule, so they had to put money into the show just to be able to get episodes out. So the whole idea of a, as you said, like, budget is worked out by producers near the start of production. Right. But I'm not sure if I can stand behind the idea that background, like, here's the background budget, they get $10,000 and all of these other guys will give the voice actors this much. It's not something
It's certainly the case in film productions.
It is, where, but...
I don't know how much of this... Like, because sometimes you watch an anime show where all the sound effects are stock. And I have to wonder if that was because they just said, well, we're not going to focus on sound design in this show. We're not going to go all out with that. Let's, you know, put that money into something else. I mean, I don't know if we can make, again, this one-one correlation between money and quality, but I do have to wonder if, you know, a show like One Punch Man, they went out of their way to put as much effort as they could into the animation. That was what they considered to be the most important thing on that show, clearly, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't know how much of that is just that animators are doing favors or that they just want to work on this show. Fuck whatever else they were going to do, you know? Like, there could be so many different reasons for it. There's like, I just don't want people to talk about budget without knowing the story, you know? I mean, I made up a story for the do-da-da-da thing, and I don't know what the real story is, and nobody does, and I wouldn't talk about that, you know, I made it up as a case study, but I would never have said that in a video or something, you know?
Oh, like, yeah.
Yeah.
There's two quotes, one by Thomas Romain, who works for Satellite, and one by Bahi JD, an animator who works a lot with Bones. And both of them talked about the idea of getting paid for a cut of animation. And I think I don't have the quotes up right at the moment, but what they talked about is how animators get paid the same amount, but they get paid depending on the length of their cut, not based on how well animated it is or anything like that.
It's so, like, per drawing, right? Like,
it's not per drawing. If you do a 10-second cut that has, like, I don't know, like 24 drawings or something, and it's a lot choppier. Even if someone's doing loads of drawings, if they're incredibly talented and doing this incredibly smooth animation for it, they're not getting paid more than the other guy. In between, artists are paid by drawing, and that's one of the things that budget does come into, and that if you have more money, if you have money available, then you can pay in between artists for more drawings to be able to kind of make animation smoother, although that doesn't necessarily mean it looks better.
But, so would you say it's somewhat fair to say that there is not necessarily an incentive to be the best animator?
Well, if you're looking for, if it's a monetary incentive, there kind of is, because if you do impressive work, then someone else is going to see it and go, please come onto my show. And then even better, someone else is going to go, please come onto my show as a main animator or as an animation director, which gets paid more. And then eventually a lot of animators end up as directors, and that gets paid even more.
Well, that kind of, you kind of make a, you're kind of doing a different career by that point. It's like a...
Oh, it's still kind of intertwined. Like, you're still directing animation, but yeah, you're involved in so many more factors. Like,
The reason I asked the question that way is simply because when I brought up this idea that budget doesn't matter towards why shows are well animated, that I said, you know, what matters is the talent. It's who's on your show, how good are they at animating? And the response I'd gotten from a lot of people was, well, doesn't it stand to reason that they're going to pay more for someone who's better.
It would stand to reason, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would stand to reason, but it's not necessarily the case. And a lot of it, again, like you said, again, we have to remind people how small this industry is and how, like, if you've got, name an animator.
Seijun Kim.
If you've got Seijun Kim working on, what's the last show that Seijun Kim worked on?
Sword Art Online Ordinal Scale.
So if you've got Seijun Kim drawing animations for Sword Art Online Ordinal Scale, that means that it's a he, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that means that he is not working on the current Sunrise show because he's doing work somewhere else, and there's only one of him. And there's not just an inexhaustible supply of amazing animators. If one of them's working at one place, they're not working at another place. And I think that when we get a show like One Punch Man, where they've gone out of their way to collect all these incredible animators, and then people say, like, well, it's because they had more money, and it's like, well, it's more like because they just collected all the best guys. They've got them all. They're all here. And,
Shingo Natsume is the director of One Punch Man and Akka, which I think is about to finish. He's worked at Gainax before, and probably one of his most notable positions is as the director of Space Dandy. And he seems to make an effort to, like, kind of get everyone's numbers, like, really connect with people and build up his resume of contacts to the point that in One Punch Man, you could totally draw connections between the people, and you could say, oh, okay, Shingo Natsume works with this guy heavily on this show, and that's why he's there. Oh, and that person knows this person, and that person's this person's, like, best friend, and it's this weird nebula of things, and it's impossible to totally describe because you can't know unless you interview every single person, but you can kind of build impressions based on what people have said and how things seem to work.
See, the funny thing about all this is that for a lot of people now, I feel like there's becoming instead of the cult of the studio that we kind of developed in the late 2000s, early 2010s, where people became fans of studios, there was studio wars. I remember there was a period where, for whatever reason, there was a definitive war between fans of Kyoto Animation and Sunrise.
What?
Like on 4chan, there was like this very clear divide where, like, Sunrise fans really violently hated Kyoto Animation fans because they saw it that as Kyoto Animation was leading the tide of Moe, and it was their fault. It was, like, because of Haruhi and Lucky Star, it was all their fault that Moe was happening, and that they were taking all the... Because, you know, Kyoto Animation obviously was putting more effort into their Moe shows than anybody else was at the time. This was before we had lots of high-quality Moe shows. So it was, like, seen as they're sort of taking all the quality away from...
Oh, God.
Away from all the mecha shows that people used to love, all the action shows, and they're putting it all into Moe. And that's the big battle that was going on.
One term I do want to contest is the use of the word effort. Just because... Because, obviously, the anime industry pays shit and is just generally a terrible place to work in. So everyone that works in that industry is nuts. So I know you didn't mean it in the way that, these are the people that put loads of effort in and these are the people that don't put effort in. But there are people that talk about it that way. And it's just important to recognize that a lot of the reason why Kyoto Animation shows look really good is because they work so damn hard. The producers work so damn hard to be able to create a studio that they could do everything in-house and be able to schedule and organize things to a T.
Yeah, it's kind of funny, like if I talked about, like, Girlish Number as a... Because when we talk about studio stuff, I always just have Shiro Bako scenes running through my head the whole time. Like, we're basically describing what happened in that episode. But in Girlish Number, that shows about them making a really terrible anime. And the funny thing about it is that the actual anime studio works themselves to the bones on that shitty anime. Like, they put in all the effort in the world. It still came out like garbage because it was so badly planned and so badly produced, you know? And I think that's something that can very well happen. Not every time that a show looks like garbage means that that someone didn't bust their ass on it. It just means that somewhere along the line, somebody did it.
Something happened, using Shirobako as an example, wanting script rewrites at the very last moment, and it, then suddenly, because of the script, or because of a producer who, or an editor who was like, no, you've got to rewrite that, then the animation gets caught up. Episode 12 in the show Shirobako, the show that was being produced in Shirobako, that shouldn't have looked good.
Yeah. Well, they just happened to have... what's his name on staff?
The old guy.
Of the name of the actual anime.
Oh, Toshiyuki Inoue.
Yeah, they had
nobody Inoue gets on. Toshiyuki Inoue. That's the rules of him, that you can't get him unless your PA works.
Yeah, so he just happened to work in their studio and just was doing outsource work for other people.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's another funny thing that I have to wonder about is, like, if we started looking at more of the outsource work and stuff like that, man, like, because I remember, I think Vanishing Trooper Incident, I think it was him who did a post once about, like, Kyoto Animation's work on Inuyasha. Like, before KyoAni was doing their own shows, they were doing, like, contract work for Sunrise and stuff, and there's like a few episodes of Inuyasha that like they were the main, I don't know if they were the main animators. I'd have to reread the article. It's been a long time, but like, it's really fascinating to think that you could see a studio's mark on a totally different studio's show. And it again creates this image. Like, I mean, every time you watch, I'm sure people have had this experience of you're watching an anime and the credits start rolling and suddenly you notice the names of seven other studios that you recognize in your credits and you're like, well, wait, what the hell were they doing? You know?
Yeah, yeah. A lot of the time it's in between work and stuff and like second key animation, but it's just amusing to me that that there was those sorts of like studio wars, this studio versus this studio, when the reality of the industry is just everyone seems to work together, get along, call each other up.
You've got this stuff like A1 and Ordet and Trigger all kind of like coalescing on shows where, like, you know, Black Rock Shooter has Trigger just like doing the action scenes entirely.
Do you remember something like that? You said A1.
I mean, A1 has also, like, has a lot of carryover of people from those. Like, A1 and Ordet collaborated on the Welcome to the Space show, and then that Dokusei film, where the director is just, like, a straight-up Gainax and Trigger alumni who, for whatever reason, her directorial debuts at A1 Pictures. And it's like, well, clearly there must have been some kind of, like... I mean, a lot of those Trigger shows and Gainax shows were produced by Aniplex, so that's probably a connection, you know?
Oh, yeah. It was kind of this thing where, I think it was 2011, where kind of, I still don't know exactly, because people give answers like, oh, we just wanted to go and make our own work, but that doesn't explain why not only did Trigger leave, but a load of other people left and got picked up on A1 Pictures shows. So there's something that happened at Gainax around 2010, 2011, and nobody knows what it is.
Yeah.
It's probably money.
It's a really funny thing, too. And I want to talk about this because, in a way, all of these revelations about the differences between studios and stuff, and, like, you know, I see a lot of... Like, I follow you and Kevin, I don't know how you're supposed to say his name, on Twitter, who talks a lot about... Yeah, Kevin, who talks a lot about individual creators and stuff. And I've noticed there's a lot of fandom springing up around that, especially when it comes to A1, because of the fact that A1 has so little of an identity as a studio that it's more... I feel like the fun of it is more seeing what random people manage to turn up there. Like... People get excited for that, but for me, it's actually made me an even bigger fan of the studios that do have a consistent voice, because it's so interesting to think that, like, Trigger and Gainax before them have always had this very specific kind of show that they've made that, like, even the ones that don't, that aren't, like, necessarily similar, you can still tell. Like, you watch anything by then, you're like, yeah, this is Gainax. Like, yeah. You just suddenly see those cuts that you're like, oh, well, only Gainax would have a cut like this or something. And it's, like, it's fascinating to think that they're doing this in almost what feels like a vacuum, except for when they show up randomly on A1 Pictures or an Ordette show or something. And so much of that, I think, is just due to the fact that Gainax did kind of come out of a vacuum, where, like, every other studio comes from an old studio, and Gainax just appeared in the 80s, you know? They just formed out of a college, and then, you know, you've got, like, Gonzo came out of them, and Trigger, and stuff like that, but...
Yeah,
like,
and then David Production came out of Gonzo, and it's, right. Yeah, a big network.
And so on and so forth. So, yeah, and, I mean, there's those charts that people have of, like, how all the studios came from all the other ones, and they're fascinating to look at, and it's really funny to just see Gainax over there by itself in its own little world with its own little tree. But when I think about how, like, most of my favorite anime come from Gainax or Trigger, and most of my favorite directors and stuff come from there, it's like they spawned their own anime culture. Like, you've got this other existing anime culture where new people kind of come in and are put into this machine that's been operating for decades, and they're becoming a part of this flow where the people running the studios are all influenced by whatever studio they came from. And then you got Gainax, who wasn't influenced by anybody except for whatever the hell they were watching on TV.
Except,
you
know? a lot of the people that are working at Trigger now and working at and worked at Gainax were people who watched FLCL is a really big one. Like, so many animator interviews, they say, "Oh, I'm inspired by FLCL, Evangelion, and all that." So a lot of those people specifically joined Gainax because they wanted to replicate that style.
I love it. I love that happens, because I'm like, that would be me if I was an animator. I'd be the guy who was like, "Oh, I'm not going anywhere but Gainax." You know, like, why would I work for any of these other studios? But I have to wonder if we had more studios doing it that way, would we have a bunch of these little micro cultures? You know, like,
kind of happening already. There's become more and more pushes to make new studios, to kind of, right. When you're a part of a big studio, then a small group of people go, "Let's go and make our own thing," because they want to have their more creative control, want to have their own advocacy to create what they value. So yeah, that's happening more and more.
I had asked that Do-Da-Da-Da producer, she was at Otakon, and I had asked her, like, you know, why this big split happened, and she kind of phrased it as like it was inevitable. Like, you know, when a producer grows big enough, they just decide they want their own studio. That's the way of life, you know.
I heard the exact same thing from Kenji Horikawa. He said that when he was initially joining the anime industry, he made an agreement that after a certain amount of time, then he would go back to, like, I think it's his wife's hometown or something, and make a studio there. So much of this is already in producers' heads. There's many studios that are yet to be made that producers are already thinking
about.
Yeah,
that are inevitable.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's an interesting thought, and yeah, it just shows again how much producers matter, and how much it's not getting talked about. But it's also because we don't have enough damn information.
Yeah. Like,
God, it's so hard, especially as an English speaking person who doesn't speak Japanese, or more importantly, doesn't read Japanese. It's very difficult to get info, and then even when you do, it can feel so, like, I feel like people in the industry kind of have an expectation that you just know, like, that you know more than you do.
Yeah.
Like, oftentimes when producers talk about stuff, they'll throw out all these technical terms that they don't explain, and you're just kind of left like, "What does that mean? I'm sorry, I didn't understand," you know?
Yeah, yeah. I think Sakugablog does a good job of that by having, like, loads of hoverovers over any, like, technical term, just so you can read a small description on what series composition or background director actually means.
I've been terrified of the day that we all decide that we're gonna start saying, like, Genga instead of animation because it's not specific enough.
Yeah.
And, like, Because it's definitely a trip, and I doubt that anybody outside the Sakuga community realizes, like, what an animator is actually drawing. Like, when you see what the animator did, and it's like, with before the color, and before the in-betweens and everything, and you're like, this doesn't look anything like the finished product, in a way.
There's so many more factors that, I think I've made the fault of focusing too much on specifically animators when you've got compositors, you've got colorists, and you've got all these other people that lead to a final product.
But it's just the reason it's so hard to talk about them is that how do I find their creative mark? How do I find, like, with an animator, again, you can easily tell that guy did that. And then when it comes to a colorist, it's like, you'd have to have a really striking color palette on, like, three shows in a row before I'd be like, well, this colorist is one of my favorite anime people, you know?
There's, at Ufotable, there's a colorist called Emi Chiba, and she was one of the founding members of Ufotable. And there's the compositing director. It's mistranslated as director of photography, but that doesn't really represent what it is. And his name is Yuichi Terrell, and I cannot decide where Ufotable's fucking color palette comes from in Kaori no Kyokai and Fate, because there's two people who both seem to, like, take credit for it. It's this collaborative effort, but it's not cool to talk about collaborative efforts. It's cool to talk about people. Right. So
it's hard a nightmare to talk about collaborative efforts, because how do you say? You know, how do you say what one guy did and the other guy? Maybe it can only happen by the unholy fusion of their powers, you know?
That's a lot of what happens with directors and writers.
So, all right, to get into some more of sort of why I brought you on and where I think that we obviously have a lot of the same concerns with this, but my concern, and the one I wanted to discuss with you, is a sort of that if we get too into the weeds of let's figure out exactly who did everything and why it's happening, I think there's a lot of simple observations that can be made that maybe aren't immediately explainable but are definitely there when it comes to studios. And one of the worries I have is that in this attempt to say, like, you know, studios aren't as important as we first think, let's try to figure out who exactly is responsible for this, we can kind of ignore the fact that, like, there's some stuff that just seems to happen at a studio, and sometimes it's weird stuff.
Yeah.
For instance, like, you had a whole video about the sort of downfall of Madhouse at one point.
Oh, not a downfall, but
yeah.
The title is quite dramatic. The Silent Fall of Studio Madhouse, where loads of people left the studio around the turn of the decade.
Yeah. And I believe it was because they went bankrupt as a result of Redline. And
I'm not sure if that's the case exactly. I think a lot of the case is just to do with Maruyama leaving, and so a lot of the contacts, a lot of the people who worked with him kind of moved on.
I had
on.
Heard that he left because he had sort of driven the company to bankruptcy or something, that they did have to file for it.
There's lots of reasons. One of the reasons that I addressed in that was that which is also connected to the money that he wanted to produce Satoshi Kon's last film, but they couldn't afford it at that studio, so he moved to a new studio to be able to fund it from scratch.
And so, unfortunately, he's basically given up at this point.
I don't think he's given up, because everything that I've heard like recently up to about last year is that they're still trying, and it's kind of just sad.
The last time I saw him, because he comes to Otakon every year, and I always go to see his panels, and the last time I saw him, he said, which I think was 2 years ago at Otakon, he said that, like, they just couldn't find a director who could do it. Mm-hmm. Like, they wanted to finish it, but there was just no director who could fill Satoshi Kon's shoes, and so, like, he's not sure if such a person exists, and that's why they haven't been able to continue on it.
Yeah, it's... Yeah, I have to believe that they're going to find someone they can trust with his work, but I don't want to give up on it, because I think that film will genuinely be amazing if it gets made.
Hopefully within Maruyama's lifetime.
Yeah.
But he, yeah, so Maruyama left Madhouse, and he went to form MAPPA, and when you look at MAPPA, you very much see the spirit of old Madhouse in it. It's like, they're doing whatever the hell they want, it seems like.
Yeah.
But then, like, and you can look at Madhouse and say, like, well, now they've got, like, Irregular Magic High School and Magicka Wars and all this shit, and be like, well, this is not the Madhouse I remember. But then sometimes they do make the Madhouse I remember. It, like, they make Parasite, that was them, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Parasite the Maxim, and it's like, well, this is, like, totally a Madhouse show, you know? And it's got, like, not just aesthetically or in the fact that it's a 90s manga adaptation, but even just the opening theme being by Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, which is, like, Madhouse has always had this way of using all these, like, metal bands. They've always had, like, Galnerius and Fear and Loathing and other bands like that in their OPs and EDs. It's such an odd Madhouse thing that it seems to have nothing to do with the directors. It might be a producer. Maybe there's one producer at Madhouse who loves metal and he's done all these shows. I haven't looked into it enough. But, like, when I look at it, all I can think is, this is a Madhouse thing. You know, this is, like, this is a studio who is continually going back and using the same, for whatever reason, the same three metal bands that they, maybe it's just that they are all signed with a label who works with Madhouse or something. I don't know what it is, but, like, to me, that is an aspect of that studio's culture, you know?
I think that's an aspect of that studio's culture which perhaps is seen more from the outside than it is within the reality at the studio. So I'm trying to, like, kind of lay off saying, oh, there's not enough evidence to support that on everything, because as you mentioned, you've mentioned before that I don't have the evidence to disprove it. So I don't really have a place in that conversation at all.
Like, regardless of, like, why it's happening, it is definitely observably happening. Like, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas have made three different Madhouse openings in the last 5 years, and they've only worked with maybe one other. I don't remember who did Brunhilder in the Darkness. Other than that, it's all been Madhouse shows. They've done a ton of Galnerius openings and stuff. And, like, it's just such it's an odd thing. And then you look at, for another studio that does something very similar, is Shaft, where they have this tendency to bring in very experimental and, like, off-kilter music into their OPs. Again, regardless of director, I mean, Shinbo's name's on everything at Shaft, so maybe it's just a Shinbo thing, maybe it has to do with labels again.
Producer, but, like, maybe it's even Aniplex producer who works with Monogatari. And
not even, I mean, Monogatari has Ryo, but, like, you know, you've got, like, they bring in Omokage Lucky Hole for the Natsu no Arashi. The Natsu no Arashi opening is by Omokage Lucky Hole. They've got the Denpa Ona opening by Shinsei Kamate-chan, and, like, all these, like, really obscure off-kilter Japanese music acts who will never do any other anime openings or endings, but they're all on these Shaft shows, and they seem so clearly handpicked. Like, someone at Shaft has an odd taste. And the reason I bring these two up is simply because, like, most of the Japanese bands that I like come from these two studios opening and ending themes. So, like, I kind of have to look at it like, man, Shaft sure knows how to find great bands, you know?
But I actually think it's the opposite way around. I think it's kind of like a circular thing in that a musician will work with a studio's show, and a producer will specifically set out a studio identity based on this person, and then later along the line, they'll be organized back together again because there was a previous success.
Yeah, so definitely, like, when I look at, like, Lisa and A1 Pictures, it seems like, like, because Sword Art Online is such a success, it's like, how could we not keep bringing back Lisa, you know, or something like that?
Yeah, it's weird because it's not necessarily a studio identity, but it's a studio perception that is somehow forming an identity, and it's not consistent, it's not reliable, but it is a weird thing that it's... Yeah. Like, I do want to find more evidence based on it, and I want, that's why I want people to interview producers, because I need answers.
Yeah. It's yeah, and that's the thing is like, what I'm just afraid of, creating a scenario where if we are so concerned about having the answers, then I'm scared that no one's gonna ask the question of like. Okay, that's fine and all, but why the hell do they keep bringing back Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas on every Madhouse show? Like, there must be a reason somewhere, and I don't know what it is, but it's like...
Yeah, I think we need to focus on questions, rather, because I think with a YouTube video, or an article or whatever, people expect to have an answer at the end, have, like, a point to it, but I feel like just introducing questions and introducing things to think about... can be effective, and the sort of framework that those decisions might be made in. So,
yeah. I think, for me, I sort of brought this up with Josh when I went on his podcast. Something that bothers me about the way that people talk about studios and individuals and people working on them is that I think there's... I feel like... How do I put this? Like, we get a question... And everyone kind of focuses on that, right? Everyone focuses on this one question and getting the answer to that question. Or, like, let's say we find an animator or, like, one guy we like, and we're just following their whole career and trying to get all the answers about them because we found an avenue. But then there's a lot of things that are observable that aren't talked about because people don't watch enough anime, if that makes sense. Like, for instance, with Shaft. There became this in the late 2000s. There was this perception that Shaft was just the Akiyuki Shinbo studio, that like he was directing every show because he's always credited as series director, and that went on up through Madoka, and then Shaft got super like there was a lot of attention paid to Shaft because of like Monogatari and Madoka, and then suddenly they're like a really popular studio that everyone's talking about, and then we have this sort of. The pendulum swinging in the other direction, where now suddenly we've got Wave Motion Cannon saying, Shinbo's dead. Long live these other directors. And then, so now we're all talking about these other directors, and like, what do they do? And then I sit here and I say, well...
Not all of us are talking about it. There's still a heavy perception that Shinbo is the only director, just not within our circles.
That's the thing, is that both of these extremes are a problem. Because on the one extreme, there's people who just think Shinbo does everything, and that's obviously wrong. But then there's this idea that Shinbo's not doing anything, and the only reason you would know that's obviously wrong is if you've seen all of Shinbo's work. Because there's so much of what's happening at Shaft that is still definitively Shinboisms. Like stuff that he's been doing since the early 90s, you know? And it's hard to say how much of that is just that... You know, Tatsuya Oishi's worked with Shinbo his whole fucking career, and or the whole last half of his career, at least, ever since he became an episode director and storyboarder. Is he just copying Shinbo, or is it that they work together? You know, like, who's doing what here?
Well, okay, it's kind of this thing, and it's nuanced, so obviously it's hard to make it a popular idea, but... Shinbo I call him the studio director in that he takes a lot of supervisory roles. So he doesn't draw, like, I don't think he's drawn a storyboard in years, but...
Well, that's the thing. A lot of people might think that, but with Shinbo, that's a complicated thing because he often storyboards under pseudonyms. Because Shinbo has said that he does not like to see his name twice in the credits. So there's been a bunch of storyboards that he's done that have been identified under pseudonyms for stuff like Hidemari Sketch and other shows like that. And then sometimes when you're sitting around on Anime News Network or something, clicking around on storyboarders on Shaft shows, some of them have one credit ever. And I have to sit there and go, is that even a real person? Or is that just Shinbo?
But then might not be Shinbo. It might be a another
somebody else
at the
under
studio.
A pseudonym. Who knows?
It might be Shin Onuma sneaking back into the studio.
Yeah, who knows? Like at some point, you just have to give up and say it's Shaft. You know, like it's just Shaft. It's just them. You know, like we can't until we've identified all of it. Which is why I want to do this project where I sort of go through all the Shaft shows and come through everybody to try to get as close as I can to the heart of this. Because the only real way to solve this is either they tell us outright or someone watches all of it and, like, compares notes on every single little thing and, like, who, and even then you can't get every answer because you get stuff like in one of Josh's interviews with Shinbo where he says, they ask him, what's the deal with the wash buckets falling on characters' heads? And he said, like, well, we were in a production meeting and someone said, wouldn't this be a part where a wash bucket would fall on their head? And he's like, yeah, that's a good idea. And now it's like a running gag through the whole show and also every Shaft show since or something. You know, it's like, well, it just springs from the ether of 10 guys in a room coming up with ideas, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And finding roots for every idea and every style is difficult to do.
Like, I think it's... I think there's this, I've said this before, that, like, the weirdest perception of Shinbo is that he's an auteur director, and I think he's the exact opposite. He's someone who lets everyone put all their ideas into the show, and that's why, like, the shows aren't weird because he's weird. The shows are weird because everyone there is weird, and he's letting them do whatever they want. And so every random thought gets put in. Because you look at his shows from the 90s, and most of what goes on in a Shaft show is not in Shinbo's older work. And yet, all the stuff that is in his older work is in there still anyways. So it's like, this is not auteurism. This is open season, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Although it's difficult to... Because pretty much any interview, if you ask about a collaborative environment, everyone goes, everyone puts in something into the show while we're very open with our staff. But right. it's hard to be able to say, okay, how much are you really asking yourself? Or are you just saying that and then... forcing them to do storyboards that are under your control or whatever.
I mean, I think auteurism would be difficult in anime at all unless you're Hayao Miyazaki and you're, like, literally correcting everyone's work, you know?
To the point that nobody likes him.
Yeah, like, how can you even control everything on a show when you've got so many people working on it, doing so many different jobs, you know? It's like the only times you can really get auteurism, I don't think you can get it in like a whole show. You can get it in like an ED where like one guy storyboarded and animated it, you know, somehow. I don't know how the fuck these inhuman people who work in the anime industry do these one-man shows.
It's ridiculous.
But yeah. So that's sort of... I guess we've sort of addressed my biggest concern about the approach of like I just don't want to see us go too much in any one direction. I don't want people to be saying like, don't talk about studios at all when there's like things you can clearly see that you can't explain yet, but you know it's there. But like, you know, I like you said, we should be putting it as a question, not as an answer. Like, I'm not going to go out and say Studio Madhouse always does metal songs in their shows. But I will say, hey, has anyone else noticed Madhouse is doing a lot of metal songs in their shows? What's the deal with that? And hopefully someone will decide to find the answer. Like, every once in a while, like, you'll mention something, and one guy will leave a comment explaining it, and I'll go, where did you find this? Like, how do you know this arcane knowledge? What corner of the internet have you scoured that I haven't seen yet, you know?
Yeah, and sometimes they're just making it up. I've seen so many people who will just make up big stories about what happened in the industry. It's like, that's amazing. I'd love it if that was true.
Yeah, I've seen some of those... It's like a like hearsay that was in a Mal thread that someone's been taking seriously for 7 years, you know?
Yeah. So many of them.
I've had a lot of moments in podcasts these days where, like, I'll explain a story and then I'll think about it for a second and go, actually, I don't know where I heard that from, so don't take that seriously. That's probably not true, you know?
I think I speak to a lot of translators, and that's so many of the things that have become common knowledge are based on mistranslations that just ends up infuriating them.
Yeah, it's a shame, and it's all of us trying to make sense of a situation where we have just paralyzingly little information, and most of what we do have is based on just looking at stuff like staring at an ANN fucking staff list and trying to derive meaning from it, you know?
Yeah. That's why pretty much every step that I take these days is to be able to either get more information or get interviews. Like, just, that is my end goal, just being able to be the guy that goes around Japan, like, talking to directors and animators and producers.
So how soon are you going to get to Japan? I take it you're on your way. Like, you're figuring that out now.
Hopefully, something. I'll be there next year. Like, cool. Hopefully. Just...
I'm trying to find... How are you fluent in Japanese? Can you speak in...
No.
Oh.
That'll be interesting. Yeah. I know people there who I'll be staying with who do speak fluent Japanese, but... dragging people along to be your interpreters isn't exactly the most ideal way for either of you to live.
Especially if they're not necessarily translators who, you know, might not give you all the nuance in what the person said. Personally, I'm trying to finally rip the Band-Aid off and learn Japanese by leaving Japanese TV on in my room and sitting here with a Japanese-to-English dictionary and just looking up words I don't know. That's my current method.
That's an interesting way. I know some of my friends who have English as a second language, one of them said, oh, I just came here, watched Neighbours, and then just looked up words in a dictionary.
Yeah. I know I have some friends who learned English from just Cartoon Network, so yeah. I mean, I know a lot of Japanese just from anime and 3 years of high school Japanese, but I did really poorly in those classes.
So, I think I got a 20% in the kanji test, and then I decided I'm dropping out.
Yeah. I've learned more from anime than I have. I'm at the level where I can watch Fairy Lou and understand everything that they're saying. So, like a show for 3-year-olds. But beyond that, I'm still stuck. So, all right. Is there anything else you wanted to say on this subject before we sort of wrap this up? We've got a good solid hour and a half under our belt here.
Read interviews. That's literally my only stance. Read interviews.
Where can we find interviews? Give us all the links that we need to know to get more knowledge. Obviously, your channel's a help, but Wave Motion Cannon and Sakuga Blog, those are the two that I follow. I don't really know any other great and Annie Pages, though it's not really active anymore.
There is this great website from one of my friends called whiteboxtreasure.wordpress.com. It's it tries to assemble as many Japanese and English resources based on, and just tries to assemble everything together to hopefully get bigger pictures. There's a lot on Yuri on Ice as well, because she's really into Yuri on Ice. So,
well, that's, you know what, I will say that I think that if there's one thing that makes all of this more difficult than anything else, it's that all of us are doing this because we're fans and we only care about the anime we care about.
Exactly.
And that's the reason there's nothing I would love more than to read creator interviews all day. But again, I follow Wave Motion Cannon and Sakuga Blog, and they never talk about anything I care about.
Like,
I'm always just sitting there like,
you can get Josh to pay for a translation of anything as long as you can say, oh yeah, they did Yu Yu Hakusho.
Yeah, it seems that way. that's why he brought me on the show, so I could talk about Yu Yu Hakusho stuff.
Yeah.
It's sad. Like, I mean, I care a lot about Shinbo and Shaft, which is why I'm doing like this epic research project on Shaft, and I'm sure that some of my fans are like, why don't you apply this to this show I like? And I'm like, sorry, buddy, I'm a Shaft guy. I like Shaft and Gainax. If it's not Shaft, Gainax, or Trigger, I can't help you, you know?
Yeah, and
I have a deep well of knowledge about those three studios.
And I am not a huge fan of Shaft shows, so I know about them is stuff people have told me in a conversation. I've never done my own research on a Shaft show.
Yeah, that's my main... If there's anything I feel confident about more than anything else, it's just Shaft, Trigger, and Gainax. I could talk about those all day, and anything else I'm like, maybe go over there and read somebody else. I might not be your guy, you know.
We're all just humans.
So is there anything you want to promote of your own before we take off here?
Just watch maybe my Konosuba and Studio Trigger videos. There's a sort of online ordinal scale video, but it's not a good video. I shouldn't say that. It's a video that I made purely because... No, I can't say for the clicks. Purely because I wanted to get the idea of how staff relationships work in the studio. There we go, that's bullshit.
Yeah, before I wrap up, I'll say that since this is a podcast, I'm going to start doing a weekly podcast throughout the spring season on this channel where I talk about old-ass anime and my history with old anime. By old-ass, I mean like 2007. So look forward to that, everybody.
In the spring season? The spring season's got so much to talk about, though.
I don't watch current anime.
Oh.
I don't know if you're aware of that. I don't watch the fall's
anime. I am actually remembering that, yeah.
Yeah. I watch it as soon as it's all over, and then I just marathon all of it. It's a lot easier for me. Anyways, everybody, that's it. Thanks again, Kanepa, for being on the show. Hopefully this will help people to have more context into how to talk about animation studios and their cultures.
Cool. Thank you.